Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and get started for this very short workshop. So thank you for joining me. My name is Sarah Davidson Squibb, and I'm a librarian here at UC Merced. And our topic for today is going to be digital object identifiers, or DOIs. And this is really just going to be an introduction to what they are and some common questions related to digital object identifiers. And for today, I'm going to be using a library guide that has some information about digital object identifiers. And I'm going to put into the chat just also a link to this guide. I'll just put that in there now, but I'll be working off of this during our time together. So a DOI, as I've mentioned, is short for a digital object identifier. This is something that we will regularly see on things like journal articles, and it's meant to be this unique string of letters and numbers that's used to get us to the information source. So it's intended to really permanently identify where the resource is. It is still identified with the content more than the location. So what happens if an article gets moved virtually and it has a DOI? It's really up to the publisher of that article is supposed to be then pointing that DOI to the new location. So normally DOIs are reliable and they should get us to articles, but I have come across times where something ends up being a dead DOI because the publisher did not change the location. DOIs these days are shown in two different formats. The active format of a DOI is going to basically look like a hyperlink. So on this guide, I have a couple examples, which starts with the https://, and then you're getting the rest of the DOI.org information, and then we get this combination of letters and numbers. So this would be an active DOI, and I have these hyperlinked, so I could click on it and get redirected to that article. Now, most of the articles that I'm showing are also articles that our library subscribes to. And so I'm connected to the virtual private network as a UC Merced staff member, which allows me to get to those articles as well. So that's an example of an active DOI. However, it's very possible that you've also seen inactive DOIs, and this is where you don't have that beginning HTTP information that allows you to generate that hyperlink. Instead, it's usually just started with DOI:, and then you get the number of it. I'm seeing more and more these days that usually there are active DOIs versus inactive DOIs. So for instance, I used to have an example for this JSTOR article. So JSTOR is a database, and this is one article in it. And in the database, they used to have just the number of the DOI, but they've actually now made them active DOIs. So they have this whole HTTPS. I personally think that's a little bit easier when you're a researcher and navigating, that you can just click on the hyperlink for the DOI and get to it. And if you do have an inactive DOI, there is a way to work around that. And I'm hoping this is going to work with my example, because sometimes these haven't always worked. But what you can do is basically you can add the HTTP information in front of the DOI number. So I'm going to try this on this example. I'm just going to copy this DOI information. And then I'm going to go back here and I'm actually going to try taking this number. And I'm going to try putting / in front of it and see if this will resolve. Okay, so it's actually this article from JSTOR. So that did work, but you can see why I like having the active DOIs, because then I don't have to do sort of that copying and pasting to resolve over to the article. But it is really helpful to know that that's how you can resolve or get to the item that's behind the DOI. I have been asked before if DOIs are universal. So, you know, do all information sources have a DOI or should they have a DOI? And not all information sources do. It's very, very common now for a scholarly journal articles to have DOIs. Sometimes you'll see it for other information sources, but it's definitely not for everything. And sometimes things have a DOI, and I'll show you how we can find DOIs, but they may not even be visible on the landing page of the article. So for instance, this is an article called Using Emotional and Social Factors to Predict Student Success. And it's coming out of the Journal of College Student Development. And it has a nice URL up at the top in the browser. But if I scroll down on this article or look at the top, I don't think they are actually publishing or showing a DOI for this article. So this is an example where I could probably just get away with using this URL for my citation, but I'll show in a couple minutes how we can see if that article might actually have a DOI available. And the DOI, I believe, really started around 1990. So again, it's very possible that older articles or information sources will not necessarily then have a DOI associated with them. So that's a little background about, you know, what is a DOI? What do they look like? How are they formatted? I'm now going to move on to some other frequently asked questions about DOIs. And one of them is just simply, where can I find a journal article's DOI? Because in particular, journal articles seem to be those information sources that have DOIs. So for me, I am normally scanning the web page where the journal article is linked from, or the journal article itself, to see if there is an assigned DOI. And you just saw me do that with this Project Muse journal article. I was kind of looking on this landing page for it to see if it was available. The one thing I didn't do yet is I didn't download the PDF to see if maybe on the PDF it was given. And actually in this case, it is on the actual PDF. So it wasn't on the HTML version, but it is on the PDF version and it's in a nice active DOI format for me. So that is normally what I will do. This, I think, is another example I have of an article where the DOI, in this case, is actually on the landing page, which is nice. So it's very visible. And I think this one, if I download the PDF, it may also be on the PDF for me. So I don't see it at the top, but here we go. So the bottom of the first page, this looks a little bit small, but it's also providing me the active DOI. So kind of just looking in those locations can be a way to find it. Now, sometimes you are not going to find the DOI on the web page, or it's not even going to be on the journal article, or maybe you're wondering if you have a book chapter, if there's a DOI. So there is a tool that I've used pretty regularly for locating DOIs, and that tool is called Crossref. And I'm going to close a couple tabs on my browser right now. And I'm going to come back and just open Crossref in a new tab. And when we get to cross-ref, we're going to see a search box in the middle. It defaults to their site search. I'm going to search metadata, and this is where I can put in a title of a journal article or a title of a book chapter. So I'm going to take this title of this journal article. It's called Textbook Broke. And I'm going to search for it in here and hit enter. It's kind of thinking about it. Crossref isn't going to have everything. And again, not everything has a DOI. But we are going to see what this comes up with in Crossref. Okay, so this is my title. So it looks like this was in Crossref. This is more of the citation. And then underneath, it gives me the digital object identifier. So a use case for this, I have sometimes worked on writing papers where I've gathered citations, but some of the citations didn't have a DOI. And a lot of times the citation styles that I'm formatting in, they really prefer having a DOI. So in those projects, I sometimes have come to Crossref and I've looked up specific titles to see if there was a DOI, and it's helped me complete my citation. So that's just an example of one. Let's try this title also in Crossref. Now I'm just going to put it in this top search box. Search box seems kind of tiny, but let's try that anyway. Okay, so this is our article, and here is our DOI. So this is a nice search tool to be aware of. And you know, one could actually just use it for searching for keywords even on articles. But this is the primary way in which I use it. Okay, another question I've had is, okay, there's a DOI on this article I'm looking at. Is it automatically a scholarly source, or is it automatically a quality source? So even though peer-reviewed journal articles these days tend to have DOIs, it does not automatically mean that you're looking at a scholarly journal. So non-scholarly items or non-peer-reviewed items have the potential to have a DOI. Interestingly enough, I've done some reading lately where they have sometimes found that predatory journals, so journals that are trying to look like scholarly journals, will use DOIs. So we still have to evaluate the information source to really know what it is and if it's quality. And then this screenshot, I'm also just showing that something that is a data set has a DOI assigned to it. So this is not a scholarly journal article, yet it still has a DOI. And then the last FAQ is also, should I use the active or inactive form of a DOI when I'm citing information? And the answer to this is really, it depends. So different citation styles may have different preferences in terms of whether to use an inactive or an active DOI in the citation that's going to be in your reference list. Now, as a general rule, I'm finding that most citation styles prefer DOIs over just a general URL, so the uniform resource locator. However, there's still some variation in terms of which citation style wants your DOI as one of those active hyperlinks, or whether they want the DOI as DOI as the prefix with the rest of it afterwards. So those are just some questions that I've heard about DOIs, and a little bit of just a primer around what they are, because we kind of see them, but we don't talk about them most of the time either. So that's what I had to present. And at this point, I'm going to stop the recording. But I want to thank you for joining me. And after I stop the recording, I will open it up as well for any questions.